And you see, we have to be careful because the fruit of the Spirit is love. And Jesus says it's because of love that people will know that you're really one of my disciples. For this reason, I don't use the word cult to describe Mormons, Jehovah Witnesses, and Christian Science. In Christianity, that's very common. Well, they're a cult. And the reason is that not because there's a specific definition, but most people have an idea what the word cult means. And they don't think of their Mormon neighbor that lives next door to them, who's the greatest guy they've ever met. Better than those crazy Christians across the street are causing all sorts of problems in the neighborhood. So you say, well, they're a cult. You know, we're trying to communicate, aren't we? We're trying to win people to Christ. We may find a technically, theologically accurate definition for the term, but is it really loving? In this day and age, is it loving? Does it win anyone to Christ by saying that? That's my own personal choice. Now, rather than being known by what we're against, we want to be known by what we're for. And so I'm pro-Bible. I think the best defense for the wolves, for the false teaching, is to know this book. To know God's Word. We don't have to spend Sunday worship service. Guys, let me tell you about this new heresy that's going on in this church down the street. You got to be aware of this. No, we're going to teach God's Word. And if you happen to stumble across someone who says, hey, I went to this church down the street, let me tell you what they're teaching over there. I have complete confidence. As a child of God, you'll say, that doesn't sound right. In fact, many of you have come up to me over the months just saying, Steve, I was talking to this guy the other day, and he said something. It didn't really make much sense to me. Is that in the Bible? I said, no, you're right. It's not in the Bible. That's wrong. I didn't think so. It just didn't seem right. You see, you can trust God and His Spirit to show you the error. Of course, it assumes that you know the truth. And so we want to study the truth. Now, I certainly see a responsibility for this pulpit. You notice we don't have a lot of guest speakers around here. I think anyone who is allowed to speak from this pulpit, we want to know what they're going to say. We want to know what they believe. But that's a very short list of people who are allowed here on any night of the week. But I don't have a personal burden of responsibility for every TV show that's out there, what every other church out there is teaching, what every random book that gets published that gets a buzz and sells a lot of copies. You remember the Da Vinci Code when that came out? How the church is just freaked out. This is going to change everything, you know? And there's a movie now. And the movie became a punchline. It was a laughingstock. I didn't see the movie, but I understand it was just stupid. And it bombed. It didn't make any box office. But I mean, we had churches in our country, Sunday morning worship service. Today we're going to talk about the Da Vinci Code. We want to teach you all the errors in there so you can talk to your friends. Why? Let's worship God. Let's study His Word. If you happen to have a friend who says, hey, did you hear about the Da Vinci Code? I heard this. You say, come on, that's not true. It's fiction. Selling a book. And it's sure not going to shake a true child of God's faith. Ultimately, my trust is in God. If you are a believer in Jesus Christ, meaning you have been born again, spiritually supernatural act of God, meaning that the Holy Spirit now indwells you, then I have complete confidence that God, through His Holy Spirit, will keep His own. That God doesn't need me or anyone else to keep His own. And Paul had that same confidence. Because as he's departing, notice how he emphasizes the protection of God in the next verse, verse 32. So now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of His grace, which is able to build you up and give you an inheritance among all those who are sanctified, among all the believers. God's Word and God Himself, working through His Spirit, will build you up. Paul says, I'm not going to be around, but I commend you to God. In the Old Testament, the children of Israel could not directly approach God. They had to approach God through the priests. And that was to teach them the holiness of God. But under the New Testament, in the church, the Bible says we are all priests. Now, I know that sounds confusing at first, especially if you have a Catholic or maybe some Anglican background. But what that means when it says we're all priests is it means we all now have direct access to God through the great high priest who is Jesus, who died for us. You see, we all have access. You don't need a middleman anymore. Now, the pastor, of course, has a role, a purpose in the spiritual growth of a person, much like a parent has a role in the spiritual growth of any child that they have been trusted with by God. But here's the thing. What happens when you have a situation where the parent never really lets the child grow up? And when it comes to the date of birth on the birth certificate, the child's now an adult and getting older by the day, but the parent still treats them like they're a child, 6, 7. They can't be responsible. They don't know that. It's not healthy, is it? Now, we obviously recognize how unhealthy it is when you hear about the spiritual abuse that sometimes takes place, often in much smaller churches where some pastor or religious leader tries to lord it over people and sort of pretend to be God in their life. That's not healthy either. But there's another side to that same coin, isn't there? What happens when you have a family, to go back to that example, where the child doesn't want to grow up? The parent would love for them to exercise more independence, would love for them to take more responsibility, but the child doesn't want to grow up. That's just as unhealthy, isn't it, in just a different way? Likewise, in the church, it is so crucial to recognize that God wants the personal relationship with you individually. He does not want you to look to me, to any of the other pastors, to any group leader that you're a part of, or just to a good Christian friend as your savior, as your confidant, as the one I need to talk to. That's not what God intends for a healthy relationship with him. Now, please don't misunderstand me. Obviously, we are always here for those of you who would like to talk to somebody, would like prayer for something. We want to minister to you who have needs. But Jesus is your Savior. And he is the one who day by day you must walk with. Because Paul's saying, I'm going away. You're on your own now, is basically what he's telling these guys. But I'm entrusting you to God, and you got his word. That's all right. You got God, you're born again, you got his word, you're going to be okay. You see, Paul didn't have a cell phone. Paul didn't have email. Paul didn't have office hours. See, we live in a different time, don't we? And there's a little danger, just a little warning in our day and age to rely too much on the arm of flesh. No matter how spiritual a person might be, no matter how many years they've walked with the Lord. Oh, my granddad's walked with the Lord for 60 years. Well, praise God. But he's not your Savior. You can't always run to granddad. Run to the Lord. Run to Jesus. That's what he would want.